Okay, our next presentation is by Ulrich Sachs. Welcome. Ulrich is professor at University of Göttingen and also a board member of the I2B2 Transmart Foundation. So, welcome. Okay.
Okay. Yeah, thank you very much for this introduction. So actually, I picked some parts for this talk which fit perfectly to the previous talk because I want to talk about the pipeline, how data actually is being generated, how we extract the data, and what we can do in order to get the data fitting for the purpose we need it for. And I showed some of the slides in Geneva already, and Rudy liked them a lot. So he asked me to put in some of them again, and that's what I did actually. Oh, I wanted to proceed here. Yeah, of course, using I2B2 Transmart. So, and as last point, I'm going to put in some aspects of the German Medical Informatics Initiative. So it's a huge 150 million euro initiative. And I show you some insights actually heading the working group on interoperability. So that's the agenda, but I would like to start with FAIR data management. I wonder that I didn't hear the FAIR word yet. So usually it's the first one, the first slide of the first presenter. I'm going to be about FAIR. And recently I read quite some funding proposals where they put in our data management is following the FAIR guiding principles. But in the end, there was no chapter about data management. I was wondering if it was worth to talk about it again. So this is the biomedical informatics pipeline we published already 3 years ago. And it depicts on the left-hand side the data side. It's blue, so data is good, data is cool, but data has to be extracted. That's the second step. So that's where we come from, actually, my group. We've been working on ETL, extraction, transformation, and loading of data for a long, long time, integrating the data. But we had to go back to the data sources and actually came out with the student project. So we're teaching a lot in medical informatics and in data science, and therefore we need examples. So examples, as Paul motivated us a long time ago, told recook studies, download data from studies, integrate it, and try to find to figure out if you know the same results which are in the studies. So we went back to data sources I'm going to show you, and of course all this is about presentation and analysis. So the example is from the American Gut Project. It's beautiful. I only can recommend you this project because we've been working with inflammatory diseases before in the project, and they've got nice data. They got microbiome data and you can download the data. That was actually the student project. So on the left-hand side, you see a lot of interesting things. You see the, of course, genomic data, metagenomic data, which you know, from forage, from stool samples, and so on. You see some interesting phenotypes. I like this phenotype: drinking water source at home. And actually, the student presented the data, and then we thought it's wrong. So he didn't integrate the data correctly because we did some simple analysis. So using I2B2 Transmart, you just pull over. So I just selected the age, and for example, this peak was actually bothering us, and we looked into the data and figured out, okay, it's very important to read the paper before you look at the data. So they included childcare centers, and of course those kids are 2 years old, and of course you need a peak there, and therefore we saw the value of data presentation and data review in this case. Then I included the analysis of drinking water, drinking the Bostonia water with a slight chlorine taste, at least for me as a European, and this is what you see. So there seems to be some interesting effect. So this is the age on the x-axis, and y-axis is size. And looking at data, you wonder why the x-axis is going up so far. And obviously, I picked one subject being 2 years old, being 4 meters and 13 big, drinking city water. So it might be effect of the city water, or maybe a screw up in data management in the study. And you see a lot of persons just by visual sight, you see they're bigger than 2 meters and 50, something's wrong. You see some others which are very small, so it's astonishing. And the students actually have to find out what's wrong with them. And what do you think, what's wrong with the small ones? It's so the size is measured in centimeters. Of course, the measured, yeah, imperial system, so they measure in feet and inches, and of course those people are 6.8 centimeters big, and therefore you need to some visualization of the data and some organized data review, that you get together the people who are responsible for the data generation, the people being responsible for extraction, transformation, and load, and maybe some epidemiologists or statisticians in order to figure out what's wrong with the data. And more systematically, that's written down in a nice paper by Hübner et al. And they tell you need, of course, you need the research plan. You need the metadata. You know, you have to know what you want to measure in the unit. So, for example, in centimeters, you have to clean the data, you have to screen the data, and then you report the initial data analysis reporting. And that's been the crucial point, which we learned in this student project, more or less, that you need to do this, and you have to report back during data collection that you can fix this problem. If you don't do it, it's too late. Then you got dirty data. And the only thing you can deal with is you just give it a dirty data flag and say, careful with this item. The measurement isn't really correct. So that was a little excursion back to the data sources, which is very interesting. Next one would be the FAIR context. So the FAIR guiding principles they're great. So last year we had Mons Barend in Geneva, the senior author of the paper, and actually he was yelling at us. He told, you have to read the paper. It's all about machine learning. The data has to be cleaned up. And that it's machine understandable. But I think it's very important as well to be human understandable, the data. And he tells very simple things like data has to be findable, it has to be accessible, it has to be interoperable, and it has to be reusable. And therefore, there's some nice new things going on in the dissemination of the TMF school. There's a association in Germany taking care of data quality of IT management for clinical trials and for clinical research. And they put together some indicators of data quality, which, you know, we saw it before in the epidemiology talk, like value distributions, for example, the age distribution, we could have seen using just a script, seeing that it's a little bit on the left-hand side, missing values and data elements, outliers, continuous data elements, you would have found the size immediately in this. And sometimes you cannot change, you just have to report it with this initial data analysis report, which I think just has to be in Transmat and in I2B2 that you just click on it. And I think we should share those scripts, because in former times, I think still now, that's a secret and everybody says, it's my script, I don't give it away. And I think we should start sharing those data quality scripts, because it's not so different. And here's one example from my colleague in Greifswald. This is a report, it's a one-pager with a nice color coding. So red is bad, blue is good, blue is cool. So you see there's some issue with those unplausible. Sorry, it's in German, I see. There's some unaffected effects. There's some unexpected effects using machine, missing values. And see, those reports, I think, should be quite similar, and we should share them. Just plug them into I2B2, plug them into Transmart as a initial data analysis. So that's actually what the FAIR guiding principles say as well. You should actually assess the data. You should make the data findable. This is the box for those who don't. Actually, my brain, I see it when I sleep. I see the data has to be findable, accessible, interoperable, reusable. And I think the reusability would be much higher if you could assess the data quality using those, the semi-standardized scripts, therefore. So some best practice examples. Here's a nice project I like a lot. It's a German-funded project trying to get together the actual collected data of patients. And it's actually a cancer scenario and just to plug it together with the real-world knowledge. Unfortunately, there's another species in between. Those are the basic researchers. So the clinical researchers are used to document data that it's fit for purpose, you know, for billing, for not being sued. But the basic researchers are working on mice or working on different other species, and they document the data a lot in Excel sheets. They have a lot of scripts in between. They have a lot of visualizations in between. And in many research projects, we just fail documenting this data. So the data is being sent via email to the to the statistician. And then they're sending an update 2 minutes later, and suddenly you get a mess up because you don't know which file it was actually. And the FAIR guiding principles tell us this has to be pipeline, and you have to figure out even after the postdoc is gone somewhere else, you should know where the data came from and what was derived from this data. This is a very beautiful solution. That's what we proposed recently in a Munich project. So here you see the contributors on the right-hand side. Those are the scientists bringing the data. This is the experiment, and it's a very simple experiment-based approach. And I think in data science, we're doing a lot of experiments. So we're collecting data, we're doing something, we're massaging the data and trying to figure out what it means. So this is experiment, this is the first result. Here's a sheet with it. Here you can see the methods, the description of the methods. Here you see the script in there, here you see the figure in it. And it's all together, and being fair, being findable, it means all can be referenced by an ID. So this is Seek ID, actually, and you can resolve it anywhere. Just using a browser, you find the original file. I think this is really important as well, talking about research infrastructures. So that's a fair context. So it's getting more complicated. You see, in the first picture, we only had data sources. We extracted, we integrated and presented. Now we have to think a little bit more in order to keep the context where the data comes from, the fair context. ETL data integration, I think there are many flavors how you can do it. We're doing it with Talent Open Studio. This is, but still, I think this is one of the very high thresholds in using I2P2 and Transmart. Actually, we should ask the question, how long did it take you to load in the first data set? So setting up I2P2 Transmart using Docker containers should be fast, but I think loading in the first data set is the most complicated thing you could do. I think there should be some improvements as well, maybe doing that in different flavors. And I think there's some workshops around it, but you know, you can talk to Christian and Teresa. They're suffering from the import routines a lot of times. But I think that's really important. And then on the right hand side, the presentation of the data. And there I like the plug-in concept a lot. So the dirty data I showed you before, or the astonishingly tall people, are visualized using the SmartR plugin done by Sascha Herzinger in Luxembourg. So this is not the original software stack, or it used to be not the original stack. We just plugged it in. And I think in the same fashion, we could plug in the initial data analysis scripts. So depending on the user rights, you can see that you can have this tab or not, and can have this initial data analysis report in there. And it would be really, really useful. So some numbers, what we did in Göttingen, so it's a small update. You see there's some vertical and some horizontal projects, some vertical projects meaning not a lot of patients, but a lot of observations. Like this one is a typical project, a clinical research unit. 1,600 patients, but 5.4 million observations. Then you got the other type of projects using billing data, and this is the new type of project we're into with the Medical Informatics Initiative. So we reuse data, and the billing data is, well, it's nice. It's nice for billing, but otherwise we've got problems as well. For example, with the diagnosis that in German law, you only can put in diagnosis in this billing data set would actually appear on the bill. So if there's another diagnosis, an additional diagnosis, which cannot be billed, it's gone. So, and for research purposes, this might be a problem. So therefore we have to have a dirty flag on there and telling maybe some diagnoses are missing in there. But you see, it's a lot of data. And we get this every year, this amount of data, there are many observations in there. And you see the other projects like intensive care data. And I have a high respect of intensive care data because it'll get a lot of data points and quite some performance issues in using this data. So we published some of those data integration aspects and data visualization aspects in Bioinformatics Journal. It's quite interesting because we're medical informaticists, but the Bioinformatics Journal liked it a lot because we had a the microbiome data type in there. And in following up in this project, together with the epidemiologist and the statisticians in Kiel, we figured out something else is missing, because usually we're looking at single patients, and some cases the trios are interesting, like the family structure, and it turned out to be quite easy to look at pedigree data as well. So in another student project, we just set up a pedigree plugin where you can create a plot for pedigrees. You can see here just the standard notations, here you can see the SNPs, and you can follow up the data, and they liked it a lot. I think that's another advantage of the plugin concept. So that's the biomedical informatics pipeline. Done? I guess not. So not really done, because if you're connecting many different locations, so if you not only got a research collaboration with three or four sites, but if you got suddenly 50 sites, you have to do a little bit more. And that's actually what we have to do in the medical informatics initiative, because every single house is doing the documentation in a different way. We got several vendors of information systems, and even if you have the same information system, it might be different because the customizing was done differently. So we have to work on normalization. And that was one of the ideas of the funding agency, awarding those 150 million euros for 10 years. So it's not so much if you divide it by the number of locations, by the number of years. But they told we allow some, you know, some competition on doing the normalization issue. And what we found out, so I'm heading the interoperability working group, I saw three different flavors doing that. First one, very natural, would be H07 CDA, clinical document architecture, which may or may not work. So the other one would be OMOP Odyssey, which I like a lot because it's simple. But a question would be, how far can we go with it? Third flavor would be using OpenEHR, which has some issues in Europe as well, because people say, oh, it's used in the UK or in Slovenia, but will it work or not? What we see is that we can use parts of all those different flavors, and the way would be to combine the best of all in order to be successful in the initiative. And interoperability, I explained it in Geneva and I showed it again, because you could say it's easy. So you're using, like, if you have to load your laptop, as Europeans, we know that we got this edgy adapter now. So it fits, the round fits into the edgy, and we can load our laptops. In Geneva, it was different. So in Geneva, I didn't take an adapter because I thought it's 250 volt, 60 hertz. What can go wrong? And then I arrived in my hotel room and this went on. So this is all 250 volt and 50 hertz. So actually, it should work. So I tried to MacGyver it. But it didn't work. In the end, I got an adapter in the reception. But here you see a nice example that interoperability is not so easy. So you have to describe exactly what you need in order to be interoperable. And that's what we do here. This is a website in English, meanwhile. So I apologize, last year it was in German, so you could not make any use of it. But now it's in English. And actually, yeah, you can see all the results about the initiative. You see current issues, see the consortia. And you see the drama. You see the conceptual phase. Right now we're here, they're going to be an audit. So an audit will be following the GCP criteria. It's something very new for the clinical community centers. That's not new for the people being involved in clinical trials before. And there will be another audit. And I think there's going to be some consolidation in between. Ordering, using the data models, using different methodologies. So interoperability, of course, we need terminologies. And I think we're shortly before the national license for SNOMED CT. So in the US, when I came here to the SACS group in 2003, there was a national license for SNOMED CT. In Germany, it's not there. So it's really, really difficult. And we're using different data models, common data use, and they're for the core data set we defined. Everybody has to deliver the core data set. There are 7 basic modules. There are 14 extension modules. The structure is based on this billing data set, which is dirty, as I told before, but quite usable. And it's an incremental approach. So actually, we don't have the German disease there, that we don't do anything until it's completely designed. You know, we just start with 80% and do the rest on the way. And we're heavily involving standardization organization. So, for example, the HL7 community is very closely involved. So we are counting on FHIR. Everything is on FHIR right now. And here are the maybe unexpected task forces. So there are the task forces we need. So interop is one. But before, we needed a task force on consent. Like, the consent was, it's the same in the US. It's very much diverging from every location. So they designed a broad consent. And we're trying hard now that every university medical center is using the same consent forms. We've been talking a lot about data sharing, so you need user and access committees, you need some rules, you need data transfer units, and I think I2P to transport will play a big role in, for example, plugging together the request for data, and then maybe, for example, in one project, then you can use the script used for the request for the execution, and the data transfer unit is using the same script, so they get exactly what they want. and of course in communication strategy on the right hand side. So I skip this. This is one of the first low-hanging fruit. I like this a lot. This is a slide from Thomas Gansland. I guess some of you know. So it looks like a timetable. I like it a lot because we just discussed a lot for the medical informatics initiative demonstrator study. And people didn't like it because they told, it's not the technical solution we want to use in our consortium. We want to use HL7 CDA, and this is I2P2 and ARMA. I told it doesn't matter. We have to show the capabilities, and for example, we have to show this lower lag, the governance lag. Here, you see that you need ethical approval, data protection approval, use and access committee approval, and some of those things were not clear in the participating projects. So this was a long way until the governance lag was there. So data integration lag was easy because we used the standard I2P2 standard. Actually, Christian and some guys in other locations were involved in the IDRT toolkit, for example, setting up I2P2 and integrating the different data types. That was easy. Then the data had to be harmonized, and then there was a repository, and the repository stayed on premise, so no data did leave the hospitals, which was important for the ethics committees and for the privacy officers. And the request instead went to the different sites, query, merge, analysis, publication, and analysis. And of course, this is interesting because we have 20 different sites. There were 19 approvals, so one was still missing, one approval, 1.8 million of patients, and 3.2 million cases. That's a lot. And you see the coverage coming along. At first, it started in the southwest, then the south filled up, and then we came to a very nice coverage. This is actually Göttingen in this spot because there was a change in the zip codes. So you oversee Göttingen because it's the gray zone, because there was some noise, new zip codes designed. We figured out in the data. At first we thought it's a mistake, but just by visualizing the data, we saw it couldn't have been different. So this is an example about comorbidity, and there are going to be some more examples making use of this data. So last slides about quickly about HIMIT project, and there's one use case which is interesting. So especially here, so you see the different sites covering all over Germany, and this is a data integration center, and it's a blueprint for the other data integration centers as well. So again, in blue, the data sources. Then you see the different ways for staging. You see the federation layer, the normalization layer here with the flavor OpenEHR, and here you see the interfaces layer using IHG profiles, and you see HL7 Fire. And I think the other stuff will be not so important, but HL7 Fire will do the thing in here. And on the right hand side, of course, most interestingly here, you see I2P2 Transmart, because you have to check the data at every single point, for example, at those ETL processes, or looking into the EHR platform, or even looking up there in the portals. So this is a quick look at the infection control use case, and I think John Brownstein will like it because it's about infection control, where we try to be quicker in order to figure out to whom the patient had contact after the outbreak, because the virus is sequenced really quickly. That's in one afternoon. It's a question of hours, but then you have to find out where was the patient to whom he had contact, which instrument was being used, and that's taking a long, long time. And our promises will be faster when we get the data. And here's some nice visualization with the threshold. You know, reminded me a lot on the Aegis times, like 15 years ago, with the syndromic surveillance. That's something we're using the real world data for. Okay, and this is the modeling effort. This is a high effort within HIMIT on the normalization layer. So you see all the sites, the current sites using OpenEHR, and here you see one of the archetypes which has to be modeled and which has to be harmonized over all the locations, but it's going on pretty well. But here you see the effort, 23 persons, and it's gonna be up to 30 persons doing data stewardship, meaning communicating between the medical informatics people and the doctors in the clinic, because we got a use case, for example, not only in infection control, in oncology and cardiology. They have to be on the board talking to people, where's the data, with your statement on the model, can we use it or not? Okay, so that's in a quick look. This is R2P2 Transmart, use it. My question would be, so in former sessions, in the European sessions, for example, people told only use R2P2 and Transmart for cleaned up data marts, use them for distribution of data marts. Don't use it before because it's too much effort. My experience is the opposite. Use R2P2 Transmart for data review meetings. Just get the data, get it in as dirty it is, and discuss the data. Discuss the ETL processes, discuss the quality measures, and discuss if you have to go back to the data capture in order to improve the data. And that's actually like I don't know if it's around in the US, so in Germany you can check if there's the currency on there or not, if you have a weird plug like this. So I think that's a very good picture there for. Okay. Greetings from Heimid, huge team. Greetings from the Göttingen Medical Informatics team, huge team as well. 50 people right now working in different projects, and I'm open for questions. Thank you very much. So who's using R2P2 Transmart for dirty data? And Dare's telling it, so. Okay. So the other ones all use cleaned up data and use it afterwards. I think it's a question of effort. I think it's right. If you don't have such a big ETL team, so you might wait until the data is cleaned up and then load it. But I think it's absolutely worth it using it for data review meetings. Yep.
We need to do is get these plugins into
Transmart. Yeah, I think I'm not sure if there will be a talk about the roadmap, because it's in the newer versions, it's actually included. And I think tomorrow you will get some insight, and the SmartUp plugin is in there in the newer versions, and it's absolutely worth it. Yeah.